Good morning and welcome to our online service for Stony Creek Baptist Church. It is January 22nd and we welcome you in the name of the Lord. Just as we start this morning, just want to mention again Sheldon, Marty, and Nicole, these three people with some medical challenges. We just want to keep them before you as we pray for them. So if you would please pray that God would touch them in a special way and protect them. It would be very much appreciated by their families. So let's open with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this glorious day you've given us. We thank you for your sustaining grace. And Father, we just pray for these three individuals we've mentioned this morning and so many others that need your touch. Father, just be with them in a special way, encouraging them, strengthening them, and be with the medical teams that are caring for them. Father, give them wisdom, we pray. And so, Father, just be with us now as we seek to glorify you, as we look into your word, as we seek to live for you, as we seek to lift up the Lord Jesus Christ this morning as we gather for worship. For we ask these mercies in his blessed name, in the name of Jesus. Amen. We are going to look at a subject that I've entitled The War Within. It's the battle of the old nature and the new nature that Paul describes in Romans chapter 7. I'm not going to read the whole section, Romans 7, 14 to 25. I have highlighted in my notes, But I just want to start in verse 21 and go through to 25 briefly. And I want to read from J.B. Phillips, his translation, because I think it puts it into the most understandable language. As Peter says in 2 Peter 3:16, that Paul is hard to understand. And that's in the New Living Translation in the NIV. And this is a fairly wordy section of scripture that is hard to understand. So I think the best way to approach it this morning is just to read from verses 21 to 25. You can read the whole part in your Bible when you have time, but you will see what I mean. In verse 21, it says, "When I come up against the law, I want to do good, but in practice, I do evil. My conscious mind wholeheartedly endorses the law, yet I observe an entirely different principle at work in my nature. This is in continual conflict with my conscious attitude and makes me an unwilling prisoner to the law of sin and death. In my mind, I am God's willing servant, but in my own nature, I am bound fast, as I say, to the law of sin and death. It is an agonizing situation, and who on earth can set me free from the clutches of my sinful nature? I thank God there is a way out through Jesus Christ, our Lord." Amen. And Phillips does a great job in translating that from the original language into our English. So I hope that's been encouraging. Have you ever been involved in a tug of war? I think back to, my childhood as a kid. I think back to the old-fashioned picnics I've attended and those things. But the biggest thing I was involved with in a tug of war was at our high school. We had what we called Spirit Days. Or Spirit Day, I think it was in the fall of the year, rallies get us all hyped up for things like football and different things like that, and just to create school spirit. One of the things we had is a big tug of war at the back of our school. It was a monstrous property, and at the very back, we had a swampy area, and that's where we had the tug of war, because as you pulled, you pulled the other team, if you're on the winning side, pulling the other team into kind of a wet, swampy, mucky thing here. So it was a thing where everybody turned out and cheered on the different teams that were assembled. And I can remember taking part in those contests, back and forth, gaining a yard, pull, everybody pulling together, digging in with their heels, their shoes or boots or whatever they had on, their running shoes, all that type of stuff. It was a real team effort. And it went on, like I said, until at last somebody pulled somebody into some muck, and they were the losers. It kind of describes what we have read this morning of Paul's experience in Romans 7, verses 14 to 25. When you read these verses, it sounds like a spiritual tug of war, which is exactly what it is. A war that pits our old nature, our fallen nature, which is sometimes referred to as the flesh or the old man, versus our new regenerate nature that we get at the point that we trust Christ. We put our faith in Jesus as our Savior and want to follow him as our Lord. I want to take a few moments this morning to briefly examine this war within us, because it is so vitally important for us as Christians to understand the spiritual tug of war that we have. It is important as we live the Christian life, as we seek to grow in our faith, we need to understand the context of what we are involved in. In fact, the Bible says, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise," in Ephesians 5:15. So we want to be wise. We are to understand the present time, Paul says in Romans 13:11. And part of that dynamic is understanding the Christian life and how we are to live it or navigate it. So, my friends, let's do that this morning. There was a locksmith's ad. It was kind of cute. It said, "Let me help you out or in." So this morning, as a team, let us help ourselves. Let our help ourselves by making four simple observations. And I'm sure that you could add to this if you were here in person as we reflect together. Four simple observations and concluding with an encouraging thought. The first one is this, that what I am talking about this morning is the normal Christian experience, that tug of war that we all face. This scripture section of scripture and what we are looking at here in verses 14 to 25 is written in the present tense in Greek. The verbs are in the present tense. If we were to look at the section just before that, in verses 7 to 13 in this chapter, we would see that Paul is using another tense, the past tense. So what does that say to us? That Paul is talking in this section about his present experience, his ongoing experience in his life. This is, my friends, a normal dynamic, a normal experience of us as Christians. This is part and parcel of our Christian growth, this struggle that goes on within us. This sounds kind of simplistic, and yet I look back on my life, I don't think there was probably enough emphasis on this to help me when I first got involved in things like Bible studies and reading my Bible more in depth and all that thing, and the kind of tug of war that was going on with me. I wondered, is this experience normal? And yes, my friends, it is. It is the normative experience for all of us. I like the way the New Living Translation puts it in Galatians 5:17. The translators do an excellent job. They say, "The old sinful nature loves to do evil, which is just the opposite from what the Holy Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite from what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other, and your choices are never free from this conflict." It says it hits it right on the nail here. What it means is to, like Paul talks to the church in Corinth in 1 Corinthians 3, verse 1, and he says, "I could not talk to you," and we would translate brothers and sisters, "as spiritual, but as sarkakos, as fleshly." So they were being signified. They were living by that old nature instead of letting the new nature, the Spirit of God, dominate their behavior, their thoughts, etc. Does the Bible teach that the Christian life, as some teach, is just a crisis experience, and then there is sinless bliss? Or that a Christian can get so spiritually mature that he or she no longer sins? They live in what is a perfect state. And the answer is simply no. No way. The Apostle John says, if we claim we have not sinned, and he's talking to believers, we make him out to be a liar, and his word has no place in our lives. So we are sinners saved by grace, and that old sin nature continues on after we have committed our lives to Christ. The best book on this struggle, and I don't know if I can hold this up here so you can see it, is called Adjust or Self-Destruct, A Study of the Believer's Two Natures, and it's by a guy by the name of Craig Massey. I don't know if this gentleman's even still alive. It's put out by Moody Press. How I miss a lot of their publications and the old Moody Monthly. Just an excellent book. It's out of print, so it would be very hard. You'd have to get it through a used book distributor of some sort online. But it is an excellent work by Craig Massey. He does a super job with this. And I haven't got any other material by him. I've got probably maybe two or three, if I can dig them up and find them in my resources. But I have this one. I keep it with me here in my home office and look at it once in a while just as a referral. It's an excellent book. So I just want you to know this morning that what you and I are going through, it is a normal experience of the Christian life, that tug of war, okay? And secondly, this morning, a believer's desire is to live for Christ. In this old tug of war, we want to live for Christ. We want the new nature to dominate. We want to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. As Peter says, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That is our goal to his glory. We want to be, as the Bible describes, people that are holy. In other words, that are set apart. That's what it means to be holy. Set apart unto God's use, unto his glory. And that's what our ultimate goal is while this tug of war is going on inside us. Remember our series a little while ago we did on spiritual warfare from Ephesians 6. Paul says, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, etc. Why do we put these things on? Why does Paul use these metaphors of a Roman soldier's armament? Why does he use that to encourage the people in his day and to encourage us now? Because left unguarded, we are left to, by that old nature, the weaknesses of our old nature, we are left open to the devil's attack on our old sin nature, or what is sometimes referred to as the Adamic nature that we get from Adam. And we don't want that to be fed. It's a dynamic that we need to put on that armor that we talked about in that series, why it's so important to put on those dynamics, those things to stand firm so we can stand, it says in the Bible, against Satan's schemes. He's a liar. He's the father of all lies. He's a tricky weasel, as my mom used to say. And he certainly is. And he will pick away at our old nature to try and get us to yield to it. The new nature that we have, we are described in places like the book of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, we are the temple. We are the temple by the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. And we get that at the point of conversion by what the Bible calls the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We are all baptized, Paul says, into one spirit, into one body. And the emphasis is here, contrary to what some people teach, only certain people are baptized in the Spirit. No, it is inclusive. It is inclusive. We are all, as children of God, baptized into the Spirit, baptized by the Spirit, I should say, that places us in the body of Christ, in the church. And that's 1 Corinthians 12, 13. You can look it up. The new nature that we have, again, being indwelt by the Holy Spirit, we are called through the baptism of the Holy Spirit to be in a progressive mode after we go through that positionally, experientially, which is a non-experiential act, actually. When we go through that, we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit, and we have what we call the filling of the Holy Spirit. And that occurs. There are two separate things, two separate dynamics, one dependent on the other, obviously, but the filling of the Holy Spirit, be filled with the Holy Spirit, it's a command, and it's ongoing, and it can happen, and it does happen multiple times in our lives. It's a regular occurrence. As we yield to the Spirit of God, we are filled by the Spirit of God, in other words, or controlled by the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 5:18 is a verse that Paul talks about this. He says, "Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit." In other words, he uses that analogy, that comparison of somebody being intoxicated and being out of control versus somebody that is controlled by the Holy Spirit, which is the filling of the Holy Spirit. And thirdly, this morning, we need to feed our new nature so that it can grow and dominate. So that it can grow and dominate that tug of war. This little poem says it so aptly. It says, "Two natures beat within my breast. The one is foul, the other blessed. The one I love, the one I hate. The one I feed will dominate." And that's it, simply. Tennyson said, "Ah, for a new man to arise in me, that the man I am may cease to be." And that is what God is trying to do in us. Positionally, we are those new creations in Christ that Paul talks about in the book of Corinthians. Experientially, God is the master potter, if you can think of that, molding us, just like clay on a potter's wheel being molded, so that in the end product will resemble what? Jesus. But the fruit of the Spirit, Paul says, is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, Paul says, there is no law. Who does that sound like? Yeah, it sounds like Jesus, doesn't it? It is the character of Jesus reproduced as fruit in us. Paul says, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." That is a verse that the reformer Martin Luther got up and said every day as he started his day. "I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live. It's Christ living in me, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." Galatians 2:20. Well, how do you feed that new nature? Well, we've talked about this a lot, and it is a big topic in the Bible, in the New Testament. We see these specifics. We put the Word of God into practice. We have to be open to and influenced by the Word of God, and it empowers us. It empowers us to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It empowers us as the Word over time, over our lifetimes. Again, it is a progressive thing we call progressive sanctification. That's why we go to church and we preach from the Bible. That's why online we have these messages, etc., why we've had the Christmas devotions, why we have a Bible study starting up in the first week of February. It's why we do these things. "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." That's why we do that. It's our playbook. This weekend, we've got some huge football games going on. And what will be instrumental, what will be the underlying element in all those games is the plays they put into practice, they put into reality, will make all the difference whether they are victorious or whether they fail. And it's the same with us in that tug of war, that old nature. We need to have the Word of God as our playbook in living the Christian life. Well, the other thing is prayer. We need to pray, as Paul says, without ceasing. In other words, we need to have an attitude of prayer where we go to God, where we ask for his wisdom, we ask for his help, we ask for his filling. We take our concerns to him, and we ask him to help us in that tug of war. The other thing is worship. What we're doing right now online is worshiping together, taking the word of God and expounding it, sharing it together. So vitally important, the excellent music that Allison puts into these broadcasts, so that you can sing, so that you can worship, you can praise God. Very important that we worship together. And it's a big catalyst in this tug of war, in this battle. And fellowship that we have with one another. Sometimes it's limited by distance or by different things, by our health and different things, but as much as possible, that the fellowship we can have, and we do have a unique and neat form of fellowship online together, encouraging one another, praying for one another, maybe a card or a phone call, all the different dynamics that we can put in to fellowship to encourage one another, even as we see, the writer of the Hebrews says, as we see the day approaching. And we need to be humble and keep that humble spirit. James says, humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. The concept here is in humility, we have a teachable spirit. In other words, like I said, with the potter's wheel, Christ can mold us. He can form us into his image. And that's so important that we are open to the work of his spirit and his word in our lives. And keeping a spirit of forgiveness. Sometimes it's hard to reconcile. That's somewhat of a different dynamic in forgiveness, but we can forgive one another. We can let things go. We can have a forgiving spirit and not build up bitterness in our lives. Don't let the sun go down on your, or let the sun, don't let the sun go down on your wrath. In other words, keep short accounts. Keep short accounts. It is so vitally important. In self-care, physically, mentally, emotionally, is so important. And having a spirit of empathy for one another, walking a mile in someone else's shoes, all go in to the dynamic of a healthy living, healthy spiritual living, which is all part and parcel, emotionally, mentally, physically, all part of that dynamic, and plays in with the dynamic of forgiveness. It's so important to keep short accounts, as the Bible says. Get things right with people before the sun goes down, as Paul says. The key to victory is found in abiding. In John 15:4, in the NIV, it says, remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. He uses the analogy of a vine and bearing fruit as us being engrafted into Christ and being part of that vine and Christ bearing fruit in us. It's abiding in him, so vitally important. And lastly this morning, and this is so vitally important, don't get discouraged. It is the number one tool Satan will use to try and get us off crack in the Christian life, to get us discouraged. When we stumble and fall, which we all do, Satan wants to keep us down there. He wants to get our eyes off of Jesus and discourage us. Don't do that, my brothers and sisters. Get back up, dust yourself off, and go on with Jesus. He loves you. He cannot love you any more than he does this morning. And the other dynamic is introspection. This is not to become preoccupied or self-occupied with looking and becoming nitpicky about stuff. No, that's not what we're trying to do. We're just trying to live the Christian life and trying to to balance things in our lives and that tug of war with the old nature and the new nature. It's good to be aware of stuff. It's good to focus on the new nature and the things that will help us develop that new nature, but we don't want to become introspective. Again, remember that Christ cannot love you any more than he loves you right at this present moment. And he loves us the same whether we are successful, whether we fail, whatever. His love does not change, my friends. So don't let the devil get on you getting too nitpicky. Again, the word of God is our yardstick. It is our canon. And sometimes our consciences are not the best or most accurate thing that we can use. Don't do that. Let the word of God be the yardstick for our behavior and be positive. Be positive in Christ and move forward in his love. Jesus loves you. I think one of the dynamics that we can use very effectively is just to be thankful. Thanksgiving and praise as weapons or tools against Satan's discouragement. I think of that verse, that famous verse in Philippians 4:6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything. So relax. Relax in this journey. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition. So prayer is more of a general concept. Petitions are specific things we're asking from God. With thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, this is his promise, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and my heart and our minds in Christ Jesus. So let's take Paul's advice and put it to work. And when will we finally be rid of this old sinful nature? Well, we will at the point where we go home to be with the Lord at the rapture, at the catching away of the church, or when we expire someday we go home to be with the Lord. We are in his hands. And at that point, in eternity, in heaven, we will no longer have our old sin nature. We will be free of that. And that will be a glorious day. But it is a glorious day now as we live for Christ, as we live with both our old nature and we live with our new nature, because we bear fruit and God works in us and we grow and we are transformed. And that's exciting. It is exciting living the Christian life, living in that old tug of war. It is exciting where we see Jesus working in us, we see Jesus working in others, and it is wonderful. It is wonderful, isn't it, my friends, what the grace of God has done in our lives and corporately in our lives together as the body of Christ, online and in person in Stony Creek Baptist Church. We have a glorious God. We have a wonderful Savior who loves us and is there to be with us 24/7 to encourage us and transform us as we walk hand in hand with him. So just be aware, friends, of this old tug of war that's within us. That's okay. That's okay. Jesus is with us and he is working on us. You know, the old adage goes, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. Somebody told me that when I was overwhelmed in university and graduate school. I'd get up in the middle of the night and Janice couldn't find me because I'd be down in my office working, just trying to get all the work done. It was impossible. How do you eat an elephant one bite at a time? That's what God's doing with us. He's chipping away at us, encouraging us, transforming us as he molds us into the very image of his son. And this is a process in which we experience joy. We experience the peace of Christ as he works, as he encourages us, as he indwells us by his Holy Spirit and transforms us over our lifetimes. So, I think in closing of John Newton this morning, a guy that really was sold out to that old nature when you read about him in his life. And he was a guy that was just overwhelmed by the sin in his life. And he remembered back to his grandmother sitting on her knee and her telling and singing to him and telling him about the stories of Jesus Christ and giving his heart to Christ and letting that new spirit, that new nature it transform him. But he understood, even as a transformed individual, as an Anglican clergyman, where people packed churches to hear him speak, he said of himself, "I am not what I ought to be. I am not what I wish to be. I am not even what I hope to be. But by the cross of Christ, I am not what I was." And amen. The old, late C.H. Spurgeon, the great Baptist preacher, said, "You are saved. Seek to be like your Savior." I think in simplicity, that's our prayer this morning. With our old nature, with our new nature, we know that we're saved. We know that we are loved immeasurably. And our goal, as we have that tug of war kind of going on in our lives, is to be like Jesus. May that be our prayer this morning, my friends. I'm sure it is the prayer of you and I. Father, we thank you for the time we've been able to spend together to look at that tug of war, that old nature and new nature that indwells us. And it is which one that we feed is the one that will dominate. So help us to do that and help us to be patient with ourselves. Help us not to be discouraged. Help us to know how much you love us with that ever-ending love, never-ending love, I should say. And just help us to be encouraged, as we seek to live for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Father, be with us now as we close our service. Encourage hearts. Father, be with those that need that special touch. Father, we just lift them up before you now. And we thank you for your love. We thank you for the finished work of Christ that we can never lose. Nothing can separate us, Paul says, from your love. And nothing can pluck us out of your hand. We are secure in you. And so, Father, help us to focus on that. Help us not to be discouraged, but to be hopeful above all things, that that faith, hope, and love is just strongly developed in our lives as we seek to live for you. For we ask these things in your Son's precious name, in the name of Jesus. Amen.